Good afternoon. Do you hear me?
Hello, yes. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers of this conference to allow me to present this paper. I'm from the Delft University of Technology, and I lectured there in the recently renewed MSc on geomatics for the built environment, which is established within the Faculty of Architecture, and I lectured there on geodata acquisition and on geodata quality. But in addition to that, I'm also editor of GM International, and recently I carried out, GM International is well known because of its Turaf product surveys, and recently I carried out a study on point cloud software in order to establish a questionnaire on point cloud software, how it works and so on. And this presentation is about my study, my findings. In addition, I'm also an international consultant. At the moment I'm working for a World Bank project in Kenya, in Nairobi, to find out what type of geo information, InterGeo, with my MSc students. This year it was held in Berlin, and it is a very good experience actually for the students, because in school class they only get the concepts and some practice, and then they get at InterGeo, they get the feeling that we are really a big community, and that the geomatics is really alive. And another remark of the students was that they liked it to be guided over the floor. Recently, I published also a book on geoinformation in 2011, which is well used throughout the world. Okay, I, with respect to the point clouds, I also want to give some examples, but before going into the examples, I want to have a look at what's actually a point cloud built up. A point cloud consists of millions, even billions, even trillions of points, but actually it is built up of what I call a nucleus. This is just an XY component. And to that, a number of attributes, a number of information is collected. And I refer here to the point cloud as a 2.5D representation of the surface of the Earth. We do have the height, of course, that is a basic aspect of a digital elevation model and digital surface model, but to that individual point, we can also store the color, red, green, and blue. And of course, what is very important is the quality indicator. A number of people forget the quality, but in my view, when you don't have a quality indicator, you don't have data at all. So this is what I call the nucleus of the point clouds. And let us have a look at a number of examples. This example has been recently published in GM International. And it is the Zhukov Tower in Moscow. And I think Armin Groen will, after this presentation, go further in the capturing and processing of the Zhukov Tower. But this is demonstrates that just such a project generates a lot of points. 100 million points were collected here with an accuracy of 7 millimeters. This project was carried out in December, and I don't know how these people, the surveyors, survived during the cold weather in Moscow, but they went up to 150 meters above the surface of the Earth, which is the height of the construction. Another source is the mobile mapping system. This is an example from Finland. There they carried out in a pilot project 22 kilometer survey of a road using a mobile laser scanner. The picture in the left upper part is the point cloud, and it is actually used. The aim was to look whether the Terra Solid software, whether it is well suited for road maintenance, and also to steer the paving machines. And obviously, the accuracy was sufficient to carry out the tasks. Another example is, and I would like to go back to my home country, the Netherlands, and that is we were one of the first to establish a nationwide digital elevation model. And a lot of people say, why, for what do you need a digital elevation model and an accurate digital elevation model? Because Holland is very flat, so you are everything is at the same height. But the problem is we are surrounded by a lot of water, the sea. We are threatened by Germany. We do have the River Rhine, which brings a lot of water. We are threatened by France with the River Meuse. So actually we want to know at the centimeter level how the water is streaming, is flooding, in order to prevent flooding and to know how we build our dikes and so on. The height model, I was in 1997, and around that time I was heavily involved in studying the shortcomings of our height models because we discovered a lot of problems. Now in 2013, 15 years later, we have a new model has been established with 10 points per square meter, and in 15 years earlier, we had 1 point per 25 square meters. And actually, that brings me actually to a rather bold conclusion, but I think that is a statement we can make when we look at the developments, that we can say on average that we do have a doubling of the number of points every 2 years. And the equipment improves, and also the number of equipment, the number of devices which are used in the world, they are increasing and increasing. But not only from LiDAR data we got our point clouds, but there is in photogrammetry a new development going on. Not only we do have UAVs, which we can use to and which gives a large impulse in photogrammetry, but we have also oblique cameras, which enable the that we see the facets, as we can see over here, and we can see facets of building. Of course, we do have also some occlusion, and that is one of the problems with oblique imagery. Here we see that we can use very small cameras bound together in a frame, and in this way to construct a multi-camera system, which gives us more information. We can carry out object detection much easier. And in addition, we do have a new development, and I think also Rakus is also busy with this new development and to incorporate that in their software, and that is called dense image matching. And dense image matching aims to give for every pixel in the image a height value. So when the pixel size is 10 centimeter, the ground sample distance is 10 centimeter, then you get 100 height points per square meter. So that means that also from this side we get huge point clouds. And the methodology, most of the approaches are based on the Sable Global Matching algorithm introduced by Hirschmüller 2008, and the nice thing about this methodology, it has been published, it has never been patented, so nobody can claim he owns it. When we have challenges, the challenge for oblique imagery, when we apply matching technology, that is that we do have a scale deviation because of the oblique view, that means the scale at the top of the image will be smaller than at the base of the image. We do have illumination changes, and we have many occlusions, as I showed you in this diagram, we do have the oblique view, and here this part of the building is occluded by another building. So, and all this work that actually, what we see is that the technology is able to construct a lot of point clouds, big, massive point clouds. But in addition, we see that some other needs occur, and one of them is to develop performance measures for this, for dense image meshing software. And this has been done in Switzerland by the researcher from Professor Nebeker, and that has been published in recently in GM International, and they tested four software packages. One of them was Sure, already mentioned by Professor Grün earlier, and he said that's the best performing one, and indeed also in this research it came out that it performed best. And in order to structure the task possible by the software packages, it was one has divided the modules, the task, in five approaches: the image rectification itself, the image matching, point cloud generation, digital surface computation, that's different from the point cloud generation itself, and then the texturing. And we see some of the software is able to carry out all the tasks, and some only carry out partly. So that makes already a difference in point cloud processing software and point cloud generating software. This is the, one of the measures. There are more. I will not go into depth in this. Is the completeness, the ratio between the number of pixels to which software assigns a depth value and total number of pixels. And here we do have the image used, and here the white spots that indicate that no matches were found. And what they found out, that especially in the vegetation area and the shadow areas, you have a lot of problems to generate height values, to find a match at all. So we do have massive point clouds everywhere. They are growing, and the number of point clouds are growing and growing. And what to do with all those points? That is a question the science is confronted with. And the answer is, of course, okay, what should we do? We should carry out a benchmark. That means we should go into the real world and look what the users want. And I would like to mention here two recent benchmarks which has been carried out in this respect. One of them is the Euro SDR survey, which started in the beginning of this year, and this survey on oblique airborne photogrammetry users and vendors view. So that means a questionnaire has been established, and that has been put on the internet, and people, interested people, they could fill in the questionnaire. And the people who are doing this are Marcus Gerke from the UZIF University of Twente in the Netherlands, and Fabio Raimondino from Italy. And the results, when you are interested, will be published in GM International in December issue in 2014. So another benchmark with respect to massive point clouds is carried out by my own university, the Delft University of Technology, in cooperation with a number of other organizations like the Rijkswaterstaat, the Netherlands E-Science Center, Figro, and Oracle. Oracle, well known because of its databases. And there is a paper on the way submitted to Computers and Graphics. The Euro SDR survey, up to now there are 130 respondents, 45% were universities, and 21% national mapping agencies. The questionnaire itself is still open, so when you are busy with oblique imagery, when you are carrying out tests and so on, you can still fill in the questionnaire. One of the questions is, what can obliques do better compared to vertical photogrammetry? So the images are taken in nadir direction. And this is what came out from all the questionnaires. Actually, four aspects were important: easier identification of objects. Most of the respondents answered this question with yes. And that's, of course, due to the fact that we do have an oblique view, so we can see the facades and other vertical objects from a side. The increased degree of automation is mentioned, increase in reliability, that is, has to do also with the increase of visibility, and you can do what is not yet possible. So that means all the type of applications that become possible with this with oblique imagery. By the way, I myself did a lot of research on oblique imagery a couple of years back when pictometry became available, pictometry technology, and Blom in Europe captured all the major cities in Europe with this technology. Then the massive point clouds of the e-science, the starting point that we can create massive volumes of data. Yes, okay, that's possible technologically, but how to process them, how to store them, that they are quickly accessible, how to disseminate that. These are actually the basic questions of this project. And again, in order to answer these questions, it is necessary to know what the users want. Do they want, for example, a digital elevation model which covers the whole of the Netherlands? Then you have 640 billion points to be disseminated and to the users. And to based on the requirements, a benchmark has been designed, okay, and three database management systems and last tools is actually a storage format, not a database management system, they were tested, and based on that, proposals for storage improvement and thus accessibility, they are further processed. Okay, a number of applications, I think that is important to consider that we do have the products, and we from the photogrammetry, we understand that we can create digital elevation models, digital surface model, auto images, and so on and so on. But we see also that there is a broad field of application, and this is not limited actually. And the more people know about this technology, the more they think they can use it. Functionalities of point cloud processing software. I structured this functionality when you, because there's a lot of software is available on the market, a lot of commercial software, and some works well for certain applications, some have their shortcomings, and therefore what I did is to, first of all, to look at what are the necessary functionalities. One of them is, for example, point cloud creation, and for example, Pix4D, a commercial software package, creates digital point clouds from overlapping imagery. Georeferencing is necessary, interpolation, and so on. These are the functionalities, and they differ from for the different software package. There is available, but not so much, general purpose software, which can handle point clouds from a diversity of sensors, not from all sensors, and not all types of digital elevation models, but TerraSolid from Finland is well on their way. A lot of software available is dedicated to a specific output. Sensors, terrestrial laser scanners, the mobile mapping systems, and so on. At the other side, we see software producers who look at who want to establish a broad palette of end products from one sensor. So you can take a lot of sensors and process the data, try to process, but you can also take one particular sensor type, for example, terrestrial laser scanner, and to establish a broad palette of products. At the end of the spectrum, we do have the application domain, we do have the surveyors and the constructors, and so on, that they use the CAD software and the ARS, the Bentleys of this world, to extend it for processing point clouds. And there are also dedicated modules for mining and so on. Development, when we look at the developments, it is far from complete. A lot is still be done, and new tools are being added all the time. Then, when it's looking at the functionalities, it is not only to necessary to look at the software itself. I think that's very important when you want to buy a software package, but it's also to look what are the ideas, what is the philosophy of the software vendor, how will it expand the software. Okay, today with GM International, we don't have our product service anymore on paper. We are in a digital world, so the point cloud processing software and all other product service we put on geomatching.com, which is accessible just by typing in your computer geomatching.com, and there you will find also the answers of the diverse manufacturers on the questionnaire which are developed on the point cloud processing software. Then, to finalize, this is a book published, and I like to write, I like to structure knowledge. That's also why I'm working at a university. I published early a book that has nothing to do with geoinformation, it has to do with traveling. And it's about biking to Turkey. The title says, On the Bicycle to Cappadocia. Cappadocia is located in the center of Turkey. Then I'm working now on a book, Point Clouds, Acquisition, Processing and Management. And a publisher, Witless Publishing, has approached me to write this book, and I plan to finish it in 2016 so that I would be able to present it at the ISPRS Congress of 2016 in Prague, at least when Professor Chen Chen will allow me to present the book. Okay.